Since the end of the Cold War, the threat of nuclear war has rapidly faded from public perception. Fears of a nuclear Armageddon don't belong in our interconnected digital world of Facebook and Instagram. Nuclear war is extinct, a dark legacy of the 20th century that we've put well and firmly in our past. Yet, in just the last 2 years, the United States has invested billions into upgrading its nuclear arsenal, in direct response to Russia doing the same. With the threat of nuclear war looming once more, the US military has a plan to come out the victor in that conflict. Hello and welcome to another episode of the Infographics Show. Today we're taking a look at why the US military wants space-based lasers and particle beams. First, how serious is the threat of nuclear war today? Sadly, it's our duty to tell you that the threat is quite a bit more critical than you may be aware of. In February of this year, it became official that President Trump was withdrawing the United States from a key nuclear weapons treaty that banned the development of mid-range nuclear weapons. The treaty specifically included non-intercontinental nuclear weapons, and was generally meant to prevent the development of tactical nuclear weapons, or weapons whose primary purpose was to be used on the battlefield and not against cities. The purpose of the ban was to limit and then slowly eliminate these intermediary-ranged weapons so that the threat of nuclear war was diminished, as it was feared that these lower-yield weapons would prove far more tempting to use in war than high-yield city busters. A low-yield exchange against military targets was likely only to prompt a similar response from the other side. Thus, were militarily attractive options that presented very little risk for escalation to full-blown nuclear war. Yet the risk was always present, as one could never predict if an enemy would see the use of a tactical nuclear weapon as a preemptive strike for the use of higher yield weapons, or if an enemy might see the act of killing thousands of its troops in one attack as worth a full nuclear response. Tactical nuclear weapons lack the assurances of MAD, or Mutual Assured Destruction, that high-yield weapons have always operated under, and thus have for decades been seen as the likeliest provocation for a nuclear war. With President Trump's withdrawal from the INF Treaty, the possibility for full-scale nuclear war is at levels that haven't existed since the Cold War, especially as Trump's withdrawal was immediately followed by the announcement that the US was restarting development of intermediary nuclear weapons. Yet, President Trump isn't solely to blame for his withdrawal, and while withdrawal is extremely dangerous, it might actually end up helping to keep the nuclear peace. That's because the United States has largely retired its arsenal of intermediate-range nuclear weapons and has not developed any tactical nukes for decades. While it does possess the capability to upgrade some of its cruise missile inventory for nuclear use, the process would be very time-consuming, and thus the US very much lacks an intermediate-range nuclear deterrent. Instead, America relies almost completely on its intercontinental ballistic missile, each fired with up to 12 variable-yield independently targeting warheads. While these warheads could be dialed down to be used as tactical nuclear weapons, the launch of an ICBM would without a doubt trigger an immediate retaliatory response from an adversary, with no time to explain to the enemy that the yield is purposefully low. Russia, on the other hand, relies heavily on its intermediate-range nuclear weapons. Faced with a very strong NATO fielding superior military forces, Russia's tactical reality is that it cannot hope to win any conflict against a determined NATO unless it makes free use of its tactical nuclear inventory. In fact, Russia defense officials have repeatedly and very publicly warned that Russia would 100% use their tactical nuclear weapons against NATO troops, whether they would use these weapons as part of the offensive operations or only in defensive response if NATO decided to push into Russia itself to seek a total military victory, is left purposefully vague. Russia cannot win a conventional war against NATO, but if it can keep NATO scared of its tactical nuclear arsenal, it might intimidate the alliance enough to allow Russia to seize back some of its Cold War holdings in Eastern Europe, as has long been its objective. In the case of war, NATO would have to seriously consider if defending Eastern Europe is worth a nuclear exchange. This is why President Trump wanted to leave the INF Treaty, in order to give the US the room to develop tactical nuclear weapons again and thus offer a realistic deterrent against Russia's use of tactical nukes. Currently, Russia is banking that neither the US nor NATO is going to respond against the use of tactical nukes with a conventional nuclear response, knowing that doing so would trigger global nuclear war. Yet, if the United States develops new tactical nuclear weapons, it can respond to Russia's use of tactical nuclear weapons with its own, giving both sides a reason not to use them in the first place. Yet the nuclear cat has been let out of the bag, and already Germany is debating if it should develop its own nuclear weapons, an astonishingly shocking turn of events for a nation that has for a long time been vehemently against the development of its own nuclear arsenal. Others in Europe have proposed that the continent develop its own independent nuclear capability, focusing on intermediate-range nuclear weapons to be operated by a joint European force. With nuclear rearmament ramping up in Europe, Russia, and the US, and other nations who have for a long time had nuclear ambitions, such as Jordan and Saudi Arabia, are now mulling the possibility of launching their own nuclear programs despite the non-proliferation treaties. The US's withdrawal from the INF Treaty was a tactical necessity given Russia's public nuclear threats, and seen by Pentagon officials as the only way to deter the use of tactical nuclear weapons and thus prevent the escalation to full-scale nuclear war. Yet the dominoes have already begun to fall, and the world has become a more dangerous place than it has been in decades. To combat the growing threats, the United States has made ballistic missile defense a top priority, and new technologies such as lasers and particle beams might at last give a glimmer of hope for the United States' very troubled ballistic missile defense programs. Though President Ronald Reagan's Star Wars was a fantastical concept with little basis in technological reality, the fact remained that Reagan was very adamant about providing the United States with a valid ballistic missile defense. Thus, for three decades, the United States has poured billions into a program many have considered the most expensive boondoggle in history. And after all that time, energy, and money spent, the nation has very little to show for it. At the start of 2019, the US had spent $67 billion on its ground-based mid-course defense system, the nation's primary defense against incoming nuclear ballistic missiles. Currently, there are 44 interceptors spread across the West Coast, and the Trump administration plans to add another 20 by 2021. The interceptors are designed to accelerate a kinetic kill vehicle toward an incoming ballistic missile and smash into it, therefore destroying the entire missile. However, to date, only 10 out of the 18 tests have been rated as successful, and since 2008, only 2 out of 5 tests were successful. The vast majority of the tests were conducted against ICBM targets that did not use countermeasures, with only one test against an ICBM that used only simple countermeasures being successful. In a real attack, each incoming ICBM would be deploying extensive and very advanced countermeasures, a scenario which the GMD system has not been tested to deal with, and one that nobody in the Pentagon thinks the system could protect us from. Not to mention that in a full-scale nuclear exchange, the system of 44 interceptors would have to stop about 3 times the number of missiles in the first wave of attacks, yet the system assigns at minimum 3 interceptors per missile to ensure a kill. Clearly, the US needs a better solution to the long-desired goal of effective ballistic missile defense, and it might at last have finally found it. Directed energy weapons offer the ability to knock enemy missiles out at, or close to, light speed, which makes it possible to destroy an enemy missile during its most vulnerable phase, its initial ascent or boost phase. The earliest a kinetic kill vehicle can hit an incoming missile is during its mid-course phase, while it's preparing to re-enter the Earth's atmosphere and when it will already have deployed extensive countermeasures or already released its multiple independently targeted warheads. During boost phase, though, a ballistic missile cannot deploy countermeasures and is extremely vulnerable to disturbances given the extreme aerodynamic stresses on the missile body itself. To destroy missiles in this phase, the US is exploring the possibility of mounting laser and particle beam weapons either in space or on very high-altitude aerial platforms. A particle beam weapon would consist of a beam made up of particles accelerated to extreme velocities approaching the speed of light. Thus, the individual atom-sized particles would normally do very little on their own, but a steady stream of relativistic particles smashing into a missile's body would act like a chainsaw, ripping through metal and either outright destroying or destabilizing the weapon. A laser weapon, on the other hand, would use nothing more than photons, shooting an extremely high-intensity laser at the speed of light toward the enemy missiles lifting from their launch pads. Both weapons have advantages and disadvantages. Particle beams would be less prone to scattering over distance, the way a laser would scatter over extremely long ranges until it loses its effectiveness. However, the particle beam weapon could only realistically be used from space, and orbital debris could interfere with the fired beam. The weapon would also have a much slower rate of fire than a laser, allowing each particle beam to target fewer missiles. A laser, on the other hand, wouldn't necessarily have to be used from space, and could instead be fired from an extremely high-flying aircraft through the upper layers of very thin atmosphere. As mentioned, though, its range would be far more limited than a particle beam, and the simple problem that a high-flying laser weapon poses is that it would take time to get the airborne platform into position, making such a weapon completely useless in the case of nuclear war, which would no doubt arrive without any warning. The weapon could be mounted in space as a particle beam, yet it would lose effectiveness against targets still deep in the Earth's atmosphere, as the beam is scattered with distance and by the effects of denser parts of the atmosphere itself. As the US invests billions into particle beams and laser weapons for ballistic missile defense, what is clear is that the aim of both these weapons will be to destroy enemy missiles during their boost phase. Not only are the missiles most vulnerable during this phase, but destroying an enemy missile as it lifts into the air presents the enemy with the very real possibility of having their own nuclear weapons rain back down upon them. This adds a layer of deterrence that may in the end be more effective than the actual particle beams or laser cannons the US hopes to add to its arsenal. Of course, some defense experts also warn that the development and deployment of these weapons might in fact prompt a nuclear war, especially when nations such as Russia are already so outclassed conventionally that they know their only real hope at victory of any kind relies on their use of nuclear weapons. Such a nation may decide that with the deployment of an impenetrable American ballistic missile defense shield, the time to strike is now before it's fully operational, or they will never be able to again.